It was in the year 1492 that Christopher Columbus and the men of his small fleet of ships set foot on dry land for the first time in more than 2 months. However, this was no ordinary landing in some busy European port. For as Columbus disembarked from his ship, he was making history. He had discovered what was to become known as the New World. The last years of the 15th century were a time of revolution in thought throughout Europe. In a continent that had for years been racked by internal division and conflict, a new spirit of inquiry had taken hold.
In the 15th century, Europe began to have quite a different view of the world. The world in which medieval people had lived was small. It was really the Mediterranean and then the north, including England and Scandinavia. In the 15th century, travel literature became a kind of passion. If you wanted to be a bestseller in the 15th century, write a travel book.
In the 15th century, almost everyone believed that the world was a sphere. There were very few flat earthers in the Middle Ages. The sphericity of the world is central to Columbus's planning, because the medieval worldview consisted of a large landmass in the northern hemisphere, wrapped around the northern hemisphere. And in theory, it was always possible to sail to the east using the western route across the ocean. The big question was, how wide was the ocean? Was this theory something which could be achieved in practice?
Now, the theory about the narrow Atlantic was that the Atlantic was navigable, or it could be crossed, in a single voyage. Now, this is quite an unconventional theory for his time, because most people believed at the time that the world consisted of one single solid landmass surrounded by a large ocean, and nobody had the faintest idea what was in this ocean.
Naturally, the rulers of the powerful states of Europe were not interested in exploration merely for exploration's sake. Their enthusiasm lay rooted in the far more pragmatic world of finance and trade. The simple fact was that travelling the long-established overland trade routes to the east had become expensive and dangerous, as the aggressive Muslim kingdoms in the region had grown in power. For the merchants of Europe, trade, which had once been reliable and steady, had become shrouded by doubts and uncertainty. New routes to new markets simply had to be found. And so, explorers and adventurers, tempted by the prospect of personal reward and the glory of discovering new lands for those who ruled over them, took to the oceans. One question vital to all of them remained unanswered, however. Was it possible to reach the other side of the world by sea? Little is known about the early life of the man who would one day answer that question. Born Cristoforo Colombo in 1451, Columbus grew up in the town of Genoa on the coast of the Mediterranean.
Columbus was born in Genoa, and his father was a weaver. And some people have thought, why should someone from this small town, industrial background, perhaps become a sailor? And the answer perhaps is that if you were a young Genoese at that date, it was as exciting as being an astronaut is today. It was the career of opportunity in Genoa, which was a trading city and which sent ships all over the Mediterranean and through the Black Sea and to North Africa and places like that. So if you wanted a career which gave you adventure, the possibility of advancement, that was the thing to be.
What drew Columbus to sail westwards remains a mystery. He may have been seeking a much-needed sea passage to the Indies and China, or he could have harbored plans to try and find the islands which were supposedly located there.
One of the things that made Columbus perhaps so sure about his voyage was that he was working on a completely erroneous view of the size of the globe. He accepted it as a perfect sphere, which was the best scientific opinion of the day, but he had it calculated as about at least one-third smaller than it is. And he also accepted the idea, which he found in some of the books that he'd read, particularly Pierre Dailly, and also there's another writer called Toscanelli, whom he had undoubtedly studied, and they suggested that Asia extended eastwards a great deal further than it did. So not only did he think the Atlantic was much narrower than it is, he thought that the land on the other side, which as far as he was concerned was Cathay, was very much nearer to the old world than it is. And a further problem was that he'd picked up from Marco Polo's book that Chipangu, or Japan, was 1,500 miles off the coast of Asia. So you can see that, for as far as he was concerned, the Atlantic was quite narrow. Once he got over this narrow sea, it was full of islands, among which would be Japan, and then quite soon he would come across the coast of China. And he was absolutely certain about this because, as far as he was concerned, what he'd read confirmed this, and also his practical experience as a sailor confirmed it.
Columbus first proposed the voyage west to the Portuguese King John I in 1484. The explorer needed financial resources, manpower, and of course ships to sail in. Unfortunately, the king was busy with the exploration of the African coast and dismissed Columbus as a big talker and boastful. Finding the resources for his journeys proved to be far more difficult than Columbus had anticipated, as wealthy monarch after wealthy monarch refused to patronize the voyage. After further unsuccessful attempts in France and England, Columbus' last chance lay in convincing the Spanish monarchs, King Ferdinand of Aragon, and Queen Isabella of Castile to finance his voyage. After 2 years of setbacks, he was finally allowed to present his case in 1486 and managed to interest Isabella, one of the most respected rulers of the period. She appointed a commission to look into Columbus's bid for aid. However, Spain was at the time involved in a crusade to drive the last remaining Moors from the country and did not have the resources or the inclination to indulge itself in what it saw as a fanciful voyage of exploration. The commission did little with Columbus's proposal over the next 6 years, and he was left frustrated and unfulfilled, unable to further his aspirations. And when they did finally reach a decision, it was bad news. They, like so many before them, failed to see the merit in his plans, which were considered to be uncertain and impossible to any educated person. Let down again and left with few options, Isabella could only suggest to Columbus that he reapply to her once the war with the Moors had been won. After what must have seemed an age, the Spanish drove the Moors from their country, and Columbus returned to the court in 1491 to try again. This time, it was not his wild theories, but his high financial demands that nearly prevented the mission. Columbus demanded to be made viceroy of any lands he might discover, to be paid 10% from the profits of any trade Spain had with them, to be awarded the title Admiral of the Ocean for himself. It is traditionally said that Queen Isabella financed the voyage personally with money raised from the sale of her precious jewelry. But this is not the case. In fact, the keeper of the king's purse persuaded the commission to agree by showing that the court spent more money on entertaining guests in 1 week than that required to fund Columbus's entire expedition.
The real determining factor which led Ferdinand and Isabella, particularly Isabella, of course, to support Columbus was the political situation in the Iberian Peninsula. The point was, as far as the Spanish were concerned, they were extremely jealous of the Portuguese, who were mounting a series of voyages at this time and had in fact been doing this since the beginning of the 15th century. And the King John II of Portugal was their great rival in the Iberian Peninsula. And if his voyages were going to produce a good route to the east and to the riches of spices and gold, which seemed very likely, they didn't want to be left behind. So the more successful the Portuguese were, the more keen Ferdinand and Isabella were to support Columbus.
King Ferdinand signed a contract agreeing to finance the mission in April 1492. Overjoyed by the good news, Columbus set to work in a small shipping port near Cadiz, known as Palos. His next task was to find ships to sail in and crews to man them. To command his ships, Columbus recruited the Pinzon brothers, Vicente and Martin, who, like many of his backers, came from ship-owning families. According to legend, many of Columbus's crew were criminals pressed into service for the voyage. In reality, however, there were an abundance of competent sailors willing to risk the dangers in the name of adventure and for the reward of gold. Of the 90 or so men that eventually made up Columbus's first crew, none were soldiers, and the ships were armed only for self-defense. The flagship of the voyage was a 100-ton triple-masted square rigger, originally called La Galega, after its place of origin, Galicia. Although the crew often referred to her as the Dirty Mary, history would remember her as the Santa Maria. Two other ships would sail with Columbus in his small flotilla, each captained by one of the Pinzon brothers. The Pinta, under the command of Martin Pinzon, was the larger of the two, whilst Vicente's ship, the Nina, measured 70 feet in length and weighed only 60 tons.
The two ships provided by the Crown came as a result of the town of Palos having committed a misdemeanor, and they were punished by having to provide these two ships and the crews. The third ship, the flagship, the Santa Maria, was provided by private investment. As it turned out, the two ships from Palos were much more suitable for this voyage because they were caravels. They were the newer sort of ship available in Mediterranean waters, but a kind of ship which was quite well suited for transatlantic crossing. It was fast and it was maneuverable. And Columbus subsequently complained bitterly that his flagship, the Santa Maria, was useless in the Caribbean because he couldn't maneuver it as effectively as he could the other two ships.
One of the greatest voyages in history began on August 3rd, 1492, as the three small wooden vessels set sail and began their journey into the unknown. Pausing only to take fresh water and extra provisions on board, Columbus headed west again from the Canaries on September 6th. He was helped by favorable winds, and the little flotilla made rapid progress. Perhaps because of the fear of discontent and mutiny amongst his crew, and also perhaps because of his natural inclination towards secrecy, Columbus kept two records of his daily progress. One, which he kept to himself, recorded what Columbus believed to be the actual distance the fleet had traveled, The other, for the benefit of his crew, suggested a much slower rate of progress.
What happens is that he has travelled so many leagues a day, and he writes down a much shorter distance in the log. The idea being that if the sailors are getting worried about why haven't they reached land, they think they haven't gone so far, so they're not worried. It was a device to keep the sailors on board, who were undoubtedly becoming a bit twitchy when the voyage had been going on for about 3 weeks, because Columbus had sold to them the idea that land would be found probably within about 15 to 20 days sailing. The actual voyage took 31 days, so you can understand why he deceived them by putting in the log a shorter distance, so that they didn't think that they had covered quite so large an expanse of open sea as they had.
During the first 10 days of their voyage, Columbus and his ships travelled a total of some 1,160 miles, flying before the steady easterly trade winds. These were, for Columbus, the happiest days of the voyage. What a delight were the savour of the mornings, he wrote. Like April in Andalusia, the only thing wanting was to hear the nightingale. However, by September 19th, the Admiral of the Ocean and his men were beginning to grow anxious. Soundings showed no sign of the ocean bottom. According to one popular myth, there came a cry of land from a lookout, and the excited Columbus ordered his men to share in a hymn of thanksgiving. Sadly, all that had been sighted was a bank of cloud. Morale among the crew dipped further when the fleet encountered light winds and progress became painfully slow. Then, on October 7th, sagging spirits were suddenly revived. Great flocks of birds, which we now know to have been part of the annual autumn migration from North America to the West Indies, were sighted heading southwest, and Columbus ordered course to be altered to follow them. Even with this encouraging sign, it seems that there was still disquiet and discontent among some of Columbus's crew. Where was he leading them?
The outward voyage lasted about 30 days, which is a long time for a medieval seaman to be at sea without sight of land. Most medieval sailors were used to sailing in coastal waters, either in the Atlantic coasts or in the Mediterranean. And so after about 26 or 27 days at sea, one can understand that they began to get a little fidgety, and there was some suggestions that they might well turn back. Another contributory factor to this would have been that after 27, 28 days at sea in woolen clothing, these men must have been feeling very uncomfortable. Their conditions were cramped. Their supplies would have been rather unpleasant by this stage.
The situation became bad enough for Columbus and his commanders to agree to turn back if no land was sighted within 3 or 4 days. However, as the hours went by, sightings of floating branches, some with leaves on them, made it obvious to all that land could not be far away. All through the night of October 11th, the little fleet pressed on before a stiff breeze. Lookouts, eager to earn the royal reward of a comfortable sum of money and a silk doublet for the first man to sight land, strained at the masthead. At about 10 p.m. on the night of October 11th, both Columbus and a lookout claimed to have seen light, like a little wax candle rising and falling. This was almost certainly an optical illusion, caused by the strain of prolonged watching, though this did not prevent Columbus from later appropriating the reward for himself. Then, at about 2 a.m. on the morning of October 12th, Rodrigo de Triana, the lookout on the Pinta, spotted what looked like a white cliff in the moonlight. This time, there was no mistake, and at daylight, Columbus began to close in on the small island, which was now clearly visible. The long voyage was over, and the course of world history about to change forever. At about noon on October 12th, 1492, Columbus's men became the first Spaniards to set foot on the soil of the New World. Watched cautiously by a few natives, Columbus and his men set up the standards of Castile and of the expedition, and, all having rendered thanks to our Lord, kneeling on the ground, embracing it with tears of joy for the immeasurable mercy of having reached it, the admiral rose and gave the island the name San Salvador.
What needs to be remembered about Columbus's so-called search for the Americas is that it wasn't a search for the Americas at all. When he made landfall in the Caribbean, what he thought he'd found was a group of islands off the main Asian landmass, which is why he called the indigenous natives Indians. Now, while he was aware of speculation about the existence of the Antipodes, he was not aware of any speculations, nor did he have any expectations about the existence of the Americas. As I said, what he thought he'd found was a group of islands off the main Asian landmass, and he maintained that that's what he'd found until the day he died.
He saw no reason to suspect that the almost naked people who timidly came forward to meet him were not Chinese or Indian. At first, Columbus was apparently quite touched by the kindness and friendliness of the Taino inhabitants of the island he called San Salvador. He wrote, "They invite you to share anything they possess and show as much love as if their hearts went with it." But a darker side to his nature also emerged when Columbus added, "They ought to be good servants and of good intelligence. I believe that they would easily be made Christians because it seemed to me that they had no religion. Our Lord pleasing, I will carry off six of them at my departure to your highnesses in order that they may learn to speak."
From Spanish accounts of the indigenous native, now the distinction itself is rather crude, but it's nevertheless quite a useful one. And these two cultures have come to be called the Arawak culture and the Carib culture. Now, the natives that were living on the larger islands, such as Hispaniola, which is now the Dominican Republic and Haiti, those were all Arawak peoples. What we can say about the natives of the islands was that they were essentially a sedentary agricultural people who grew a number of staple foodstuffs and some crops for clothes, and who did a certain amount of metalworking.
By sign language, the natives indicated that other islands lay to the west, and Columbus put to sea once more, kidnapping six inhabitants to act as guides. During the next few days, the expedition discovered numerous other islands, finding upon them many exotic and new plants, fine trees, maize, and sweet potatoes. But apart from the tantalizing evidence of the ornaments worn by the natives, there was no sign of what was increasingly becoming the object of the Spaniards' chief desire, gold. Told by the islanders of a larger island, which they called Colba, Columbus, believing this might be the mainland of China, resumed his voyage, and on October 28th, anchored off the coast of Cuba. But again, his hopes were dashed. A party dispatched inland in search of evidence of Chinese or Japanese civilization returned empty-handed, apart from news of a strange practice they had observed. They had met many people who were going to their village with a firebrand in the hand and herbs to drink the smoke thereof. It was Europe's first experience of tobacco. Rumors of gold on the island were rife. Columbus was even told of an island called Babek, where the people gathered gold on the beach by candlelight. Encouraged by these tales, Martin Pinzon and his Pinto slipped away alone on a private gold-hunting expedition, leaving Columbus with his two other vessels to sail on. On December 8th, Columbus reached yet another island, and the admiral, seeing the grandeur and the beauty of this island and its resemblance to the land of Spain, christened it La Isla Española, later to become Hispaniola. Ominously for the island's unsuspecting Taino inhabitants, who welcomed Columbus in the same fashion as the islanders elsewhere, the admiral also noted the rich ornaments worn by a local chief and his entourage, and confided in his journal that the people were very cowardly, fit to be ordered about and made to work, sew and do anything else that might be needed.
When Columbus made landfall on what people say is usually described as Watling Island, the people he met were naked. They seemed to have no known form of religion, so that they fitted the role of barbarians. There was also another stream of writing with which he was familiar, which said that there are some people who are born to rule and others who are born to be slaves. And in the usual way, of course, it turned out that the Spanish were born to rule and these barbarians were born to be slaves.
On December 22nd, Columbus received a message from Guacanagari, a powerful chief in what is now northwestern Hispaniola, inviting him to visit, enclosing as a gift a richly ornamented belt with a gold buckle. This was a temptation impossible for Columbus to resist, but sadly for him, disaster struck. Exhausted by their all-night revelries, the crew of the Santa Maria failed to keep watch on the night of December 25th. Just before midnight, the ship ran onto a reef and was wrecked. Although with the help of Guacanagari and his people, the crew and most of the contents of the Santa Maria were saved, Columbus was now left with only the little Nina, much too small a vessel to carry all of his men back home to Spain. This gave Columbus the opportunity to do what may have already been long in his mind, to establish a permanent settlement in the newly discovered islands. With the increasing evidence that gold must be plentiful and close at hand, there was no shortage of volunteers to man the new settlement. Using timbers from the wrecked Santa Maria, a small fort was constructed on a sand spit on the northwestern coast of Hispaniola, and 39 men selected to garrison it. On January 4th, 1493, Columbus and the Nina set sail on the first stage of a long voyage home. It was 2 days later that, quite by chance, they found the Pinta, and Martin Pinzon and his men gave Columbus the news they had been waiting for. They had found large amounts of gold. Columbus and his men now had all they had dreamed of. They even managed to capture 24 natives after a brief skirmish at Samana Bay, and these helpless individuals were hauled aboard the Nina to be presented as prizes to the Spanish monarchs.
And so Columbus was going to limp back to Spain with very little to show, very little tangible to show. And in the process of the return voyage, he'd lost contact with the other ship, the other remaining ship. And he feared that if the other crew got back first, they would give a very bad account of what had been found and achieved in the Caribbean.
Eventually, however, the Nina came safely to anchor in the Azores on 18th February, 1493. The next stage of the journey home brought further drama, as high winds forced Columbus and the Nina to dock in Lisbon in Portugal the kingdom of King John the First. Of course, it was John who had called Columbus a big talker and boastful, and had declined the opportunity to fund his expedition. Now, that very same man had been forced into Portuguese harbor aboard a ship laden with the fruits of his voyage. What was John to do? His counselors advised him to imprison Columbus and seize the Nina, but John found it in his heart to be merciful. He let the explorer go with a rueful, rhetorical question: why did I let slip such a wonderful chance? Allowed to resume his journey, Columbus dropped anchor at Palos at about noon on March 15th, 1493, after a voyage lasting 224 days. He was soon to discover that the mortally ill Martin Pinzon had arrived in Spain shortly before him, but, fortunately for Columbus's reputation, had died before he had the opportunity to tell the story of the voyage to King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella. On April 20th, Columbus made a triumphant entry into the court at Barcelona. He came bearing gifts, including his beloved gold, surrounded by his band of captured natives, resplendent in their exotic dress. Columbus received a hero's welcome and was granted all of the titles and privileges he had demanded. It was the Genoese explorer's finest hour.
The voyage itself was a massive personal triumph. It vindicated all he'd said about his voyage across the Atlantic. It vindicated the support he'd received in order to mount that voyage. And most of all, it vindicated or gave vindication to all the contractual arrangements he'd made with the Spanish monarchs.
Ferdinand and Isabella lost no time in authorizing Columbus to make a second voyage to the newly discovered islands. This time, however, there was to be a major expedition, and its objective was clear.
The second voyage set off in an atmosphere of high excitement. There were 17 ships, and they were loading in mind quite a different thing, what we would think of as a colony, a permanent settlement. Well, when they reached Hispaniola, the natives, particularly the native chief with whom Columbus had made contact on the first voyage, they no longer seemed to be the docile, sweet-natured, kindly natives whom he described to Ferdinand and Isabella when he got back after the first voyage. All the people in the fort of Navidad whom he'd left behind were dead. The fort had been destroyed. There was a great atmosphere, perhaps, of fear.
Columbus's men had been attacked by the Taino natives after a dispute over gold and the native women and had been massacred. There is, however, no evidence that Columbus expressed particular regret or concern, though he did prevent vengeance being exacted on the loyal chief, Guacanagari. Rather than rebuild the ill-fated settlement, Columbus chose to establish a new colony on the north side of Hispaniola. Named Isabella, it was badly sited, in an unhealthy location, and it would bring Columbus little but trouble. Leaving the colonists to establish themselves, Columbus resumed his exploration. It is now that the darker side of his nature began to re-emerge. The voyage was marked by continual clashes with the natives. Some, the Caribs, were accused of cannibalism by the Spaniards, although there is no evidence that this was true. It may, at least in part, have been used as an excuse to justify the increasing cruelty which the Spaniards displayed towards the natives.
His attitude to the natives changed when he found that they were much more aggressive. But there was another thing, I think, which is very important. Back in Spain, people expected gold. This was over and over again what people looked for, asked for, what had lured so many people onto those 17 ships. If you were going to find gold, you needed labor. the only labour that there was that of these unfortunate natives. Now, Genoa was a slave society. From far as Columbus was concerned, to turn to enslaving the local population was an answer. Faced with a hostile population, the need for labour, Columbus undoubtedly began to be much more brutal. And as brutality bred brutality, as he was more aggressive, so the natives responded by attacking the Spanish, and you had a spiral of violence.
Returning to Isabella in June 1494, Columbus found that life in the idyllic colony, which, left in the charge of his brother Diego, was already turning sour. Many of the colonists, disillusioned both with the conditions there and with Columbus's erratic leadership, had sent messages of complaint back to Spain. The colonists were openly at war with the native people of Hispaniola, who were sickened by the Spaniards' uncontrollable lust for gold. Attempts by the Taino to resist were ruthlessly crushed by Columbus and his men, who made use of savage dogs and war horses, things never before seen, let alone encountered by the natives. Disappointed and irritated by the amounts of gold that had so far been discovered, Columbus proposed instead to sell the natives as slaves. Some 1,500 were rounded up, and about a third of them shipped home to Spain.
Queen Isabella was rather unhappy with this idea of Indian enslavement. She regarded the natives of the Caribbean islands as her subjects and didn't think it was appropriate that the subjects of a Catholic monarch should be in slavery. So she actually outlawed or banned the practice of slavery, and Columbus was made to take the Indian slaves back. But even though slavery itself had been outlawed, in practice it still continued. And the Spaniards had an institution, commandery. And in essence, what this meant was that groups of natives were rounded up and used as forced labour. And the encomienda, the commandery, meant that they were allotted to particular Spaniards. So in essence, they were still slaves, although in name they weren't. Now, the net result of all this was an absolutely devastated population, devastated partly because of disease, but devastated through overwork and neglect. I mean, the Spaniards treated them as little more than animals to be used and abused and to be worked into the ground until they died. One really can't find any positive impact from Spanish involvement in the islands. It is, in my opinion at least, wholly negative in the sense that the Spaniards practically wiped out a whole indigenous people.
In 1492, the population of Hispaniola has been estimated to have numbered several million. By 1550, cruelty, murder and disease had reduced the Taino to less than 500 survivors. Columbus' return to Spain in March 1496 was a much less triumphant affair than that of 3 years previously. Despite his ingenious and outrageous claims, it was apparent to most people that Columbus had not reached Cathay or the Indies. The lands he had discovered were not producing gold in the quantities which he had promised, and the inhabitants, or those who had survived, were not proving willing converts to Christianity. Even Ferdinand and Isabella became disillusioned with the whole business of the new lands in the West, and only the desire to prevent foreign powers from reaping any benefits from the island caused the increasingly reluctant Spanish monarchs to continue their backing of Columbus. Despite all this, in March 1498, Columbus was given permission to undertake a third voyage, partly financed by the sale of some of the Taino slaves he had brought back with him.
The 1498 expedition was an example, I think, of Columbus going for broke. He took a much more southerly route into the Indian Ocean. But something happened that neither he nor anyone else had foreseen. he came across an island with three hills, which he called Trinidad, and he sailed along the south coast of Trinidad and into the great Gulf of Paria. The Gulf of Paria is a freshwater, almost a lake, a great basin between Trinidad and Venezuela. And he noticed it was such a large quantity of fresh water that it created turbulence when it met the sea. He knew that to produce huge quantities of fresh water like that, he needed a very large river system. And a very large river system requires a very large landmass. And of course, in his own view, there was no landmass that of that size in the Southern Hemisphere. So rather than looking at the evidence and coming to the conclusion that he discovered, as it was, South America, he looked back in his own medieval baggage and came up with an explanation which would enable him to have a large river system without having a large landmass. And he hit upon the myth of paradise.
He wrote to Ferdinand and Isabella, "Your Highnesses will gain these vast lands, which are an other world." Unfortunately, Columbus was now suffering from complications arising from the dysentery which he had contracted during the previous voyage. This illness, it is now thought, was affecting his judgment and mental stability. And it was perhaps this that caused Columbus to engage in some flights of fancy which were extreme even for him. The new lands, he suggested, might contain great stores of gold, which is treasure, and with it, whoever has it may do what he wants in the world, and may succeed in taking souls to paradise. And this latter task, Columbus suggested, might prove easier, for this new discovery might even have been the Garden of Eden. It is most unlikely that Spain's hard-headed rulers were impressed by their admiral's more fantastic theories. Moreover, they probably served to further increase their doubts as to his reliability. These concerns would be strengthened further by events when Columbus once more arrived at the ill-fated colony of Isabella. Columbus found Hispaniola in a state of ferment and rebellion.
Columbus saw a colony as a trading base with a population that would rotate. The colonists saw themselves perhaps as permanent residents. There was also this further difficulty that initially gold came from stripping the Indians of the ornaments that they had, or images that they had. But when that was exhausted, and there was never very much of that kind of thing in these Caribbean islands, the only source of gold was in the rivers of Hispaniola, panning for gold. And this wasn't a rich source. So that people felt perhaps that they'd been lured to the colonies on the promise of gold. And when they got there, all there was hard labor, disease, near starvation.
Unable to restore order to the colony himself, Columbus wrote to Spain, asking for the assistance of a lettered official. This was probably the pretext which the Spanish government had been looking for, and they dispatched a nobleman, Francisco de Bobadilla, who had judicial powers both to deal with the rebels and to investigate the accusations which had been made against Columbus and his son. Columbus did nothing to help his own case by the arrogant fashion in which he received Bobadilla, and quickly found himself imprisoned, charged with concealing the gold of the island and wishing to make himself and other accomplices lords of the islands and give it away to the Genoese. In fact, modern scholars incline to the view that Columbus was being used as a convenient scapegoat for the wider failings of Spanish colonial policy. Whatever the truth, Columbus was sent back to Spain in chains and in disgrace. Columbus was stripped of all his powers in the colonies, although eventually, in March 1502, he was given permission to undertake another voyage of exploration, on strict condition that he did not set foot upon Hispaniola. Insofar as he made it clear, Columbus's aim during his final voyage was to explore further to the north of the other world which he had discovered. He may have believed that he would find a strait leading at last to the long-sought route to Asia. But it is equally likely that he was simply motivated by a lust for gold, which had become nothing short of a mania. Ironically, at one point during this last voyage, Columbus was to reach the Isthmus of Panama, a mere 12 miles from the great Pacific Ocean, whose existence Columbus had never suspected. But apart from this, the voyage was a sorry tale of cruelty, sickness, storms, and frustration. And after being shipwrecked for a year in Jamaica, Columbus returned to Spain for the last time in November 1504. Here, whatever dwindling hopes Columbus had harbored of a return to royal favor received a fatal blow with the news of the death of Queen Isabella. It was she who had been his major champion. Though far from the life of poverty painted by popular legend, Columbus did spend his final years in a fruitless pursuit of the awards and privileges which he claimed were rightfully his. On May 20th, 1506, Christopher Columbus died unmourned and unmarked by the wider world. It was a lonely fate for the Genoese sailor, who, for good or ill, had taken medieval Europe through the gates of a new age and given her a new world to make her own.
You can look at Columbus and say, here is the man who discovered the new world. Where would we be without America? And that gives you an idea of a man of supreme importance. From 1492 onwards, there grew in the new world a different society. And as time went on, that society became more and more important until, of course, in modern times, it is perhaps the most important society in the world. So, it depends how you look at things. Do you think that the first man matters? Because if you do, Columbus matters. If you think that somehow or other there are tides of history and sooner or later someone would have done it, well, you can decry what he did. But I think it's quite justifiable that his statue should be so prominent in Spanish territory, even if many in South and Central America would perhaps prefer that he never came.